What's happening, people? Back with another reaction, back with some more Eurythmics, and we're going back to their 1987 album Savage again. Once more, I wanted to give a shout out to Izzy. He was the one who sent me the Beethoven I Love to Listen To tune, which really blew my mind and made me sort of begin to realize that my understanding of what the Eurythmics have been and the sound that they've put forward was, again, very narrow and limited, which is the same thing that happened to me with Duran Duran. So much in the way that I've come to just, you know, fully embrace this, you know, headfirst dive into Duran Duran's music, I'm beginning to feel the same excitement for the Eurythmics in terms of, you know, what they are and the music they've made is much beyond what I understood in a very limited and narrow sense through the hits like Sweet Dreams and Here Comes the Rain Again, which I love both of those songs. And, you know, to me, it's like, oh, that classic, like, early to mid-80s synth-pop sound, where it's, you know, like, wicked synth work, but, you know, kind of heavy, dancey percussion. But now I realize, you know, they've made tunes that fit that general description, but even then, it's, you know, that's only part of the story in songs like that. And I've also come to understand that they're experimental, you know, sonic, avant-garde, like, cutting-edge, abstract explorations are much beyond what I knew. I knew Annie Lennox was a good singer, but maybe not to the degree, or definitely not to the degree, and the way her voice is used, like layered kind of like polyphonic articulations of her singing, and you know, the way that like Stewart will use certain production styles and certain sounds to sort of augment or to accentuate Annie's voice, I've really come to appreciate in just a short amount of time. So once again, shout out to both Dave Stewart and Annie Lennox. Shout out to Izzy and others who suggested that exploring the Eurythmics would be a good idea, because I'm only now really beginning to understand how true that is. So yeah, we're up to the fifth tune on Savage. It's called Shame. That's a very straightforward concept, but again, it has a straightforward denotation, but the number of potential connotations is, you know, seemingly limitless almost, in the sense that we're talking about shame, which is like humiliation or embarrassment relative to other people, particularly in public or social settings. And in that respect, it relates to expectations toward or attitudes about mores and morals, and the way in which, you know, there are certain standards of behavior that have come to be accepted, maybe not in a perfect consensus, but, you know, in any given culture or society, there are behavioral norms and social norms that eventually sort of settle into regularity. And then if one behaves in a way or says things in a way that fall outside those bounds, there is a sense of judgment from others. Now, there, you know, I just reacted to a tune by Duran Duran called Do You Believe in Shame? Now, there's a, you know, some story and context behind that tune and where it came from and what Simon was thinking about when he wrote it. But just that question in general does get to the idea that shame is dependent upon the person who has engaged in such actions, right? Like, if you don't feel any connection to other people, or if you're not concerned with the ways in which they're judging you, you won't feel shame, even if your actions, perhaps on a wider view or from the assessment of a third party, is warranted. Like, even if you should be embarrassed by the perspective of many, there are perhaps some people who are so craven, so crass in their pursuit of what they desire, that they might not feel any shame whatsoever, again, even if their actions do actually warrant it. So again, it's a very simple concept, it's a single word title, so that you can go so many different ways with it, but it's not a single word title that single word title, say that three times fast. But it's not one that's sort of impenetrable when it comes to speculating about it. I just reacted to a tune they did on their Sweet Dreams album called Jennifer. That felt much harder to speculate about. I mean, it's a name, and unless, you know, there's an obvious connection to a famous person, which I couldn't really think of in the moment, then, you know, you can't really make much of that. But the concept of shame, there's a lot already on the table before you've even said a single word in terms of lyrics. So I am interested by that, and I will also be interested to see, you know, what sort of sonic atmosphere these lyrics and the idea of shame is going to manifest within. So let's get to it. This is Shame by the Eurythmics on their 1987 album Savage.
very airy, almost extra dimensional sort of feeling. Celestial planes. Oh. And then within those kind of like chime progressions, there's that sort of like tight, like tinny melodic layer. Getting more forceful, those. Which, the composition there. But now we have this sort of like halting, staggered percussive feel. She said, everybody wants it, even though it doesn't exist. Is that what it was? See if that comes back around. Shame in the dance halls? On the TV? In the media. So is this a, maybe it's about like the way in which like there's so much judging and like nosy introspection of other people's behavior in life. Extended vocal that like cut through the actual lyrical lines. It's a great song. I'm still sort of trying to get a full scope on the social assessment that I'm hearing, but sonically, it's glorious. The tune feels like sonically very uplifting. But it's interesting because I think there is a critique in here. It's like the end of a, it's like the outro of a vocal trance track, but this is 87, so vocal trance is at least like 5-6 years away. At the very least, like 4. Oh my god, how are you gonna fade out when you're doing that keyboard magic, that like piano keys magic? Oh man, again, the more I listen to albums in the 80s of different artists, I feel like labels and, you know, studio executives were doing a gross disservice to music fans out there, just fading songs like, you know, right when they're really sort of flying high in the sky. You know, I keep going back to that example from Tears or Fears, where the studio version of Shout on Songs from the Big Chair, it fades out right as Roland starts to play that epic guitar solo. And I, like, when I heard the studio version, I was like, wait, you cannot be serious. How could you fade out right there? And even though that might have just been like a final kind of little flourish as the song was naturally sort of petering out, I would have liked to have heard the end of that without a quick fade. So yeah, again, that's not the Eurythmics' fault. That's something that's, you know, I've come to see is a much larger issue in music production, especially like on major labels. So yeah, that's a criticism that's, you know, directed elsewhere. But ultimately, I really enjoyed that. As I said, it, like, I think there is perhaps a critique inherent in the way they're talking about all the shame in the dance halls and the TV and the media. I'm just not quite sure exactly how it's being directed or targeted. But the song itself, like musically, made me feel very like uplifted and redeemed. You know, so perhaps there's a sense of like, you know, it's a normative prescription to, you know, dissipate in one way or another all the shame in the dance halls and the media and the TV. So yeah, let me know if you got an angle on this one. Let me know if you have a thought about the Sonics. I thought that was a really cool musical journey, like, you know, independent of the lyrics, even if in some ways it's representative of the lyrics. So yeah, I really enjoyed that. Let me know what you think. Other than that, I will see you next time. Peace.